I have the great privilege this morning of introducing Callie Wright. I first heard Callie speak in Myrtle Beach in one of those Carolinas. I'm getting my North and South Carolinas confused these days. I know we don't now, but so it was South Carolina, where we're going to be next year for our conference. Anyway, Callie really impressed me. I've always had friends who were transgender or have some non-standard orientation, but I never knew how to approach them, how to ask the questions, how to find out more about them. And Callie is just the most warm, open, generous person, and it was an eye-opening presentation, and I very much appreciated it. So I encouraged Maggie to get her on the agenda for this weekend, and I'm glad that she's here to join us. One thing Callie does want you to know, she's going to go through a little bit of her biography herself, so I'm not going to go over all of that. She is a podcaster. It's the Gaytheism podcast. Gaytheism Manifesto podcast. And she wanted you to understand something, that when she wrote the bio, she hadn't quite yet discovered that AHA has its own LGBTQ alliance. And so she was madly in the process of creating her own for the secular movement. She had the good fortune of talking to Sincere, I presume after we hired him, and she's come on board with us. So I'm very happy this morning to introduce Callie Wright. You're going to enjoy this, and I'm sure she's open for lots of questions afterwards.
All right, raise your hand in the back if you can hear me. Okay, just want to make sure I'm loud enough. So thank you guys so much for coming. I'm really, really excited to be here. I don't get to do a ton of these, so this is really cool. So the title of my talk is Gaytheism 101. We'll get into the word stuff in a minute. A little bit about who I am. I am the host of a podcast called The Gaytheist Manifesto, where we talk about the intersection of atheism, secularism, humanism, social justice, LGBT issues, and those kinds of things. I am a transgender and queer woman. Again, we'll get into definitions in a minute. I'm an activist, so I've come on board with the AHA's LGBTQ Humanist Alliance. So many letters. And I'm really excited to be a part of that. I'm also probably the biggest Star Trek fan you've ever met. I'll take anyone on in trivia, quote me on it. I also have to apologize real quick, because I'm going to disappoint everyone and tell you that I'm not here to talk about how I pee. Because when I decided, like, hey, activism is a thing that I'm going to do, that was obviously the first thing on my mind, is having extended discussions about my bodily functions. So, good stuff. This presentation does include some pretty heavy stuff. We're going to talk about struggling with depression, anxiety, losing loved ones, suicide, that kind of thing. So, if it gets too much, please don't be afraid to take care of yourself. So, my passion and what I do in activism is the intersection of atheist, humanist, secularist, and LGBTQ activism. And what I try to do is to make the case for why I think that's important. So the podcast was started because of two main reasons. When I came out and started being involved in my local LGBT community, I was really shocked to find myself being actively and sometimes aggressively proselytized to at events for the LGBT community. And aside from that, when I started getting involved in the atheist community and the secular community, I realized that there just weren't that many people who are actually part of the LGBT community pushing these conversations on our behalf. And that's not to say that those people aren't out there. There's just not many of us. So I decided that my activism would be atheist and secular outreach to the LGBT community, and vice versa, LGBT outreach to the atheist and secular humanist community. So I want to talk about a few terms first. And these aren't things that, like, you're not going to understand the presentation if you don't completely have the definitions down. A lot of this stuff is kind of more keep it in your back pocket in case you run into it in these discussions. So queer is a word that kind of has some baggage to it, right? You know, back in the day, queer was the go-to insult for anyone who was gay, for, you know, a masculine woman, a feminine man. Anytime you wanted to insult someone, that was the go-to word. But largely, and I respect people who feel different, but largely we have reclaimed that word. And we now typically just use it to refer to someone whose sexual orientation isn't heterosexual. Transgender. Me. A transgender person is someone whose gender identity is incongruent with their birth assigned sex. And that's a really, really fancy way of saying that when I was born, the doctor saw a penis and marked an M on my birth certificate, and I grew up and told him he was wrong. And gaytheism is simply a silly made-up word. I didn't make it up. I wish I could take credit. That describes the intersection of the issues that we're talking about here. Intersectionality is a word that I could probably do like a 3-hour-long presentation on all by itself. But basically, it describes the way that issues interact with one another and that you can't separate things like race from class or gender from sexuality or poverty from race and those kind of things. So that graphic kind of illustrates it. It kind of put things in perspective for me. So the question is, why? Why do I forego time with my family, forego sleep, eat crappy fast food on the road all the time to give these talks to people? There are a lot of reasons, but instead of just spelling reasons out, I kind of prefer to tell stories. Raise your hand if you recognize this person. Okay, not many, that's cool. So this is a picture of Leela Alcorn. Leela Alcorn is a 17-year-old transgender girl who committed suicide on December 28, 2014. Her suicide note was auto-posted to Tumblr, where she described being sent to conversion therapy, being rejected by her parents, isolated from her friends, and eventually she ended her own life. Now, this is a picture of the vigil that we held for her, because this happened in the city that I live in, about 15 miles from where I live. So we held a vigil in front of her high school, right by the highway where this happened. And there were like 400 people there. It was an amazing thing to see. I never thought in a million years that I would see that kind of love and support for the transgender community. And at these events, typically there are LGBT affirming clergy there. And I want to make it clear that I don't begrudge these people's presence at these events, because there are members of our community who are people of faith, and a vigil for a person who committed suicide is not the place for that kind of debate. So I let those people do their thing, and that's fine. But there was a minister speaking there, and in the course of her speech, she used the phrase, "I believe God was a first responder on the highway that day." And the groaning. So by your response, I think you get why that's a horrible thing to say. But basically, that implies that if you're a person who believes in God, that this God stood by and watched all of this horrible stuff happen and then decided to show up after the tragedy was complete. So when that happened, that was the moment that I knew that my LGBT activism had to also be secular activism. So, thank you. And on the surface, this kind of makes sense, right? Because the religious right in this country and in a lot of places around the world is basically the number one reason that we are not treated like human beings in society, right? And we can have a discussion about whether or not someone is a true Christian or a true Muslim or all of that, but we can all agree that the people leading that fight are using their holy books to do it, right? So the way that I look at it is secular activism is LGBT activism by proxy, because we're all better off when religion doesn't get to make the rules. But there's actually more to it than that. And we can go through the things like we're an abomination, having sex with our partners should warrant the death penalty, that we just in general deserve to die. Real quick, I want to do a thought experiment, okay? And I'm not going to ask anybody to raise your hands, because if you're not comfortable outing yourself in any way, that's totally fine. But think to yourself, if any of you were once very religious, even fundamentally religious, did any of you just wake up one day and say, you know what? Doesn't make sense anymore. Right? You know, okay. There's always two or three. Oh, God. So the point that I'm trying to make is that no one does this shit overnight. Right? At least most people don't. Right? It's a struggle. And why? Why do people struggle with this? Why do these deconversions not happen overnight? And in my mind, the answer, at least in part, is identity. Most of us are handed an identity when we're born. We are handed the identity of a heterosexual, cisgender, Christian person. And many of us are free to explore any other facet of our identity. So are you an artist, you're a musician, you're a poet, you're a techno whiz, all of that stuff is up for grabs, but your basic identity as a heterosexual, cisgender, Christian person is simply assumed. And whether we want to believe it or not, that cultural programming is incredibly powerful. And I think most people can generally see why this is a problem for queer and trans folks. But the thing is, many religious people have the same struggles. Atheists often scoff at people who take religious debates so personally, right? Because the argument you so often hear is that I can say that I don't think that you're correct. I can attack your beliefs without attacking you as a person. The problem with this is that for many or most believers, their religion is a deep-seated part of their identity as a human being. When you attack someone's religion, they may often feel the same way that I feel when someone says something terrible about gay or trans people. You and I know that's not the same thing, but we're not having that debate with you and I, unfortunately. So for many folks, their religious beliefs are their identity, and though you and I know that those things aren't really in the same category, for those people it often is. And leaving that behind requires a shift in the way that you see your identity. The identity that you're told by your parents, your friends, your teachers, your society, and the media is not only the right one, but the default one. And any identity other than that is wrong and deviant. So, to illustrate this point, tell me if you think you know who that is. Yeah. So, given the context of the presentation, you can probably guess that's a pre-transition picture of me. And this is a really superficial way to make the point, but what I'm trying to get at is that the same difference you see in me maps to the same difference I feel inside as a person, and that's often the same difference I hear people talk about when they're leaving their religion. And many of the consequences are the same. The fighting, the struggles, the hard conversations, and on the other side, the joy of finally being honest about who you are. So the thing to know about me is that I didn't grow up in a fundamentalist religious environment. It was not a big deal to anyone in my life that I stopped believing in God. So I was a teenager before I found out what religious sentiments towards gay people and trans people generally are. Anybody else remember when Ellen DeGeneres came out as gay? Okay, cool. So I was still going to church with my grandma at that point, and the pastor obviously had a problem with this, and he was going over all of these businesses that had pulled their advertising from her show as a result of her coming out as gay. One of those businesses was Wendy's. So guess where grandma and I went for lunch that day? Where she was very sure to tell the 16-year-old kid working the window that we were there to support their strong stand in morality. So, because that's not the environment I grew up in, a lot of this connection was kind of lost on me, and it took me hearing other people who did come from those environments to get it. So, to elicit the same reaction I had during that experience in you, I'm gonna play a game. I found several quotes struggling with religious, sexual, or gender identity, but with certain identifying words taken out, and I want to see if you can spot the difference. It makes you feel inferior, like you're not quite human. I kept it to myself for a long time because I was afraid to talk to other people about it. I've been so careful about hiding stuff from my dad, but he saw my today. He preached at me for hours, and I've had panic attacks ever since. I knew if I came out, I would lose my job. I pretend to be just to be accepted by my best friends. I pretend to be at work because my boss is really conservative. My dad told me my sister got cancer because I don't know what to do. I think my husband knows. He'll make me leave if he finds out. I can't lose my kids, but I don't know how long I can keep this up. It's creepy, isn't it? So, now that my persuasive powers have convinced you that all of this makes sense, why do we care so much? Because we all know the last few years have been pretty great for the movement, right? We have marriage equality. We have trans people in Time magazine. We have a trans TV show. We have the president mentioning trans people in a State of the Union address. We have the impending lifting of the ban on people serving openly in the military. And we have that mess. and you knew the but was coming, right? I'm going to tell you two stories here why this matters. So Obergefell v. Hodges is the case that made it to the Supreme Court that decided marriage equality. There's another side to the story that's not often reported on, and personally, I think it's the more important story. This is Jim Obergefell and his husband, John Arthur. They'd been together for 20 years, because that whole being gay thing's just a phase, of course. In 2011, John was diagnosed with ALS, which is a terrible degenerative disease, I'm sure we all know. In 2013, the Supreme Court struck down a key provision of the Defense of Marriage Act, conferring legal benefits to married same-sex couples in the states where it was legal. So Jim and John decided at that point they did want to get married, because they had the same legal rights as everyone else then. But Ohio, it wasn't legal there. Problem was, John was almost on his deathbed at this point, so they had to get a Facebook campaign to raise $13,000 for a medical transport plane to get them to Maryland. Once the plane landed, they were married on the tarmac. And because Ohio is, in fact, the worst state ever, that's not where Jim and John's journey ended. Eventually, they recognized that because their marriage wasn't legal in Ohio, that Jim's name wouldn't be on John's death certificate as the surviving spouse, and that their family burial plot wouldn't allow them to be buried together because their marriage wasn't legally recognized. That's when they filed suit. And of course, there are lots of details in between, but that's the case that made it to the Supreme Court that decided marriage equality for all of us. The problem is that John Arthur didn't live to see it. John Arthur died 3 months after they were married. So Jim had to celebrate this victory without his husband at his side. So obviously this was a great victory, but I think it's important to remember what the fight cost. Second story, you heard me earlier on mention Lila Alcorn, a 17-year-old trans girl who committed suicide after being rejected by her parents and sent to conversion therapy. I'm going to skip through a couple of these because I'm running short on time. Here we go, let's just do this. I've decided I've had enough. I'm never going to transition successfully, even when I move out. I'm never going to be happy with the way I look or sound. I'm never going to have enough friends to satisfy me. I'm never going to have enough love to satisfy me. I'm never going to find a man who loves me. I'm never going to be happy. Either I live the rest of my life as a lonely man who wishes he were a woman, or I live my life as a lonelier woman who hates herself. There is no winning. There's no way out. So there was a worldwide outpouring of love and support for Lila and for the trans community. There were vigils all over the country. And pardon the pun, but this was hailed as sort of a come to Jesus moment in society for the trans community, right? Because the line that we hear so often is that this is a terrible tragedy, but people are finally talking and that's a positive. The problem here is that a 17-year-old had to commit suicide before that happened. The thing is, many trans kids feel like their lives are worth nothing because no one cares about them. They see a note like Lila's where they admonished us to fix society, and they see the hashtags, and they see the memes, and they see the art, and the idea that they get is that they will find the love they crave if they kill themselves. Now, reading that note wrecked me for a couple of reasons. Obviously, a 17-year-old committing suicide is sufficiently tragic, regardless of the circumstances, but religion's role and the similarities between her situation and mine really punched me in the stomach. In her note, she talked about not being able to be satisfied with the life she would live after transition, and that's what kept me in the closet for 28 years. I remember driving home from work one night when things were particularly bad and thinking to myself, you know what, if I crashed my car, maybe it would look like it was an accident. Now, lest you think I simply came here to depress you, there is another side to this. Hearing lots of people talk about their experiences as queer or trans people can sometimes make it sound like it's a miserable experience, and I'm not going to lie, sometimes it is. Experiencing hate is awful. But if I want someone to take a single thing away from my story, from any success that I have, from any difference that I make in this world, is that I'm not exceptional. Despite the challenges that we face from ourselves and from the world, if we have support from our friends, our family, and our communities, and access to competent medical care, we can and do thrive. And anytime someone compliments me for being so open with my story and so honest about the things that I've struggled with, I remind them that there's no way in hell any of this would be happening without my support system. Because the support system is vital for anyone, because we're human beings and we're social creatures. But for vulnerable people, it's even more so. Coming out wasn't an act of courage, it was an act of desperation. And the support that I received allowed me to step out just a little further. And every time I stepped out further, I was met with more love and more affirmation and more support. And I am the person I am today because of that love and support. So coming out was the single most terrifying thing that I've ever done in my life. It's a rare occasion that you have to expose your deepest secret to the public, but if I was going to deal with who I was, I didn't have a choice. But living my life as the person I've always known myself to be has been the most liberating and joyous experience of my life, despite the struggles. I've never been happier in my life. I've never been more comfortable in my own skin. I've never felt better about the way I relate to people, and I've never felt more free. The problem with religion is not that its ideas are incorrect. There isn't a person in this room who hasn't been spectacularly wrong about something at some point, right? The problem with religion is dogma. And the dogma surrounding, the dogma of one man, one woman, or born a man, always a man, born a woman, always a woman, these ideas don't exist because they're good ideas. They don't exist because they're likely to make anyone's life any better or any happier. These dogmas exist specifically because a religion said so. And speaking out against those dogmas is very directly to speak out against Bronze Age philosophy. I believe with all of my heart that this community is the place to be for equality. I believe that we can and should be leading the fight for equality. As atheists and secularists, we know that religion continues to be an impediment to almost all human progress. And it's by fighting the notion that faith is a good way to know things that we really allow ourselves to see our fellow human beings for who they actually are. And I can't say enough good things about the way I've not only seen us embrace this change, but the way I've seen us take the lead and be part of this change. So, in closing, we've had a lot to celebrate between marriage equality, trans visibility, there's been lots of good stuff happening. But we have a very, very long way to go. We can and should be leading on these issues. I've seen and felt and heard the love, the support, the affirmation that this community is capable of. So let's keep doing that. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Callie. Please, if you have questions, come to the mic.
While people are making their way to the mics, I want to make it clear that this is a safe space. So if you have a question that you feel is too personal, too invasive, too rude, go ahead and ask it. You're not going to hurt my feelings.
Hi, I'm Ellie Altman, and I'm the proud mother of a trans son.
Holla!
But you know what? Medicare, the cost of surgery is not covered.
Yeah, I mean,
the cost of surgery is not covered.
So this is a double-edged sword, right? Because more and more big companies are adding trans-inclusive health benefits, but trans people are also chronically unemployed and underemployed, so it doesn't really matter that those benefits exist because we can't access them. So, yeah.
I'm from North Carolina.
Bless your heart. We won't hold it against you, I promise.
Where the legislation just passed the HB2 bathroom bill, Would you like to comment on that?
Oh, God. I wasn't joking when I said I could have done an entire presentation. But here's the deal. Trans people are far more likely to be the victims of violence than the perpetrators of it. I'm not going to pretend that every trans person is a pure-hearted, you know, great person and will never hurt anyone ever. But trans people are not predators. Trans people are the victims of violence far more than they are the perpetrators of it. We are no threat to anyone. You know, basically we're dog whistling, right? Because we say that we care about sexual violence, but, you know, how many people are sexually assaulted in this country that no one does anything about? The minute trans people get involved in the conversation, all of a sudden it's the kids! You know, so, yeah. That's in a nutshell.
I guess I'm going to make a couple of comments. One is that the Freedom From Religion Foundation was founded because the... Annie Laurie Gaylor, who is the founder, had so much trouble with religion when she was trying to support women who had abortions that she identified religion as the real problem. So, and the second thing I want to say is that the lesbian, gay, transgender, bisexual, queer issues are tied up with women's position in our culture. And unfortunately, the women who, some or maybe even many of the women who were involved in women's liberation in the beginning rejected gay women, which is, or queer women, which is really awful. And I think people are changing their minds. But our faiths are so intertwined.
They absolutely are. That's what intersectionality is. You can't separate these issues from one another, I don't think. So I agree.
Hello. Thanks for coming. I was surprised that you used the word queer, and that's kind of an accepted term that's being used now. It seems to have a lot of negative connotations, so I was wondering why, you know, that's still being used.
So there's power in reclaiming slurs. Mm-hmm. When we take the thing that people use to insult us and make it our own, we remove that power. I 100% respect people who feel differently, and if someone ever told me they didn't want to be referred to that way, or they didn't wish, you know, they wish that I didn't use that term around them, 100% respect for that. I have zero issues with that at all. But the reason is there's power in reclaiming slurs. So that's really what it's about.
It's not a PC issue with you.
No. No, I don't think so. Because like I said, it's the target of the hate.
Yeah.
Reclaiming that term and removing its power.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Hi. I thought you said at the beginning of your speech that you can't separate race and class. Is that what you said?
Well, the idea is that basically every social justice issue is intertwined. So if we talk about race, we have to talk about class. If we talk about any of these things, we also have to be talking about gender. We also have to be talking about poverty. We have to be talking about all of these things together, because you can't solve one issue without solving the other, if that makes sense. For example, staying in my own lane, you can't solve homophobia and transphobia without solving misogyny.
Because but I think that's different than race and class, and I think I would respectfully disagree with that characterization.
You don't think race and class are intertwined?
No.
Okay.
I think they're separate.
Okay.
I enjoyed your speech, and I'm also from North Carolina. And I just wanted to reiterate something that you said about the problem with religion. They polled our General Assembly in North Carolina and found that 60%, or even more than that, slightly more, align with a fundamentalist Christian theology. And so, that's behind HB2. So.
Thank you. I really enjoyed your talk. I thought you were very inclusive in your language. And one of the things that I would like to hear you talk about is dealing with bigotry in religion. One of the things that I recently experienced that I hadn't thought about, especially from the atheist community, humanist community, was how especially Hasidic Jews are responding regarding this bathroom issue. A friend of mine, a historical friend of mine, recently gave a huge amount of money to New York because he was very worried that his, he's Hasidic, and his wife, he's terrified that his wife might actually share a bathroom with someone who's transgender.
Sorry.
And it's really hard for me to be like, that's cool, dude, I'd like to hear your opinion about that. And, you know, again, we don't really talk about, especially like Hasidic Jews in this conversation, but I'm hearing more and more of it. And I'd like you to comment about that discussion and how that might pertain to the transgender community.
I try my best, not always successfully, to stay in my lane. I don't think I'm really qualified to comment about anything in the Jewish community because it's not a community I'm part of or very well informed about. So it's not something that I feel I'm qualified to really opine on. All I can say really is that, you know, you can present the numbers. If someone's afraid that their wife is going to share a bathroom with a trans person, you know, we know 82% of sexual assaults are committed by someone close to the victim, right? Whether it's husband, wife, coach, teacher, so on and so forth.
But it's not, they're not worried about assault. It's actually that Hasidic men and women do not touch people of other genders.
Well, see, there you go.
Right. that's their family.
That's a perfect illustration of why I try not to have an opinion on that kind of issue.
Sorry about that.
No, you're fine.
So I go to high school in Colorado Springs, Colorado, and my high school just opened a gender-inclusive bathroom, which is super cool. First one in the state of Colorado, and our LGBT GSTA club or whatever has like 6 or 7 out trans kids who are like finding places to live throughout the city. And like, my question is not as diplomatic as other people's, but I was just wondering, like, how do you go up to someone? Is it polite to ask and be like, so what do you want me to call you? Because I don't know right off the bat what pronouns to use, but I feel like asking that is super rude.
It's not actually. So what you can do, and I will never promise you that you'll never ever offend someone by doing this, but it's generally considered perfectly polite to ask someone discreetly what their pronouns are.
Okay.
You know, if you want to use the most inclusive language, it's not someone's preferred pronouns, it's someone's pronouns, because it's not something they prefer, it's something that it's who they are, right? So you just discreetly, what's your name? What are your pronouns? Cool. Because, you know, we don't want to engage, you know, everyone in a deep discussion about their identity, but it's perfectly fine to ask someone how they wish to be referred to. So, you know, it's generally polite to ask those questions. What you'll find, I don't see this so much in younger people, what you'll find, some binary trans people are very not accepting of non-binary people. So when someone assumes my pronouns and assumes them correctly, that's an affirming thing for me. But because non-binary people live in a world where no one is assumed to be non-binary, that's problematic for them. So that's where I kind of have to try to set my privilege aside and be fine with someone asking my pronouns, because I don't want people assuming anyone's, if that makes sense.
Thank you for your talk.
Yeah, thank you.
Well, I don't know if I'm treading on anything here, but I'm confused about all this in a way, the complexity. So let me ask you this way, the way I see it, is it correct? It's just a question of biology, and you're who you are by the way you were born, the way you were formed and created. So you're you because that's the way you were born you. So what's not the respect? It's so simple to me. What's the complex abilities? Answer this for me. To me, it's so simple. You're who you are. You were born. Why should I not respect that?
Well,
that's my question.
Yeah, I think there are two main reasons for that. One,
but I don't
is that,
hear worth a damn. So.
Oh, sorry. Okay. So
I'm having hell here.
I think there are two main reasons for this, right?
That's why I hate to get these
Oh, you're
questions.
Fine. People, generally speaking, are more comfortable with very black and white binaries. So something is either one thing or it's the other thing. There's never an answer that's in between or a gray area, right? And I think the existence of trans people challenges that conception because we appear to be one thing, maybe, and then turn out to not be that thing. And then I think the rest of it is just kind of good old-fashioned, a lot of people fear and hate what they don't understand and can't relate to, which, you know, I mean, obviously that's a whole nother talk, but I think...
Is my point of view okay?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, it should be as simple as you say. It really should be. Unfortunately, that's not the world we live in.
On the bathroom issue, just a simple personal point. Sure. Having been sexually abused at age 7, mm-hmm. it's not that I think trans people are sexual perverts, but I fear that it makes it easier for a sexual pervert to gain access to women, children in their bathrooms.
So the thing to think about there is so you're acknowledging that trans people aren't the problem, right?
No, it's not that they're the problem.
So why would the response be to limit our access to society as a result?
Because it's so easy for somebody to put on a dress and say, I'm trans, somebody who's a pervert.
But does that mean I'm less deserving of equality because someone else might take advantage?
But that doesn't make me less deserving of protection either.
Right, but the thing is, there are hundreds of municipalities across the country where these laws are in place, mm-hmm. and it hasn't been a problem. What we find is middle-aged men abusing young boys in men's bathrooms. I found 10 instances of that happening in the last 2 months, and no one has said a thing about it. But all of a sudden, when trans people enter the conversation, then we have to pass bills, and we have to change laws, and we have to protect the kids. I want to make it clear, sexual violence is something that I'm passionate about. Mm-hmm. I helped found a nonprofit that supports sexual violence survivors. So it's a topic that's very dear to me, and it's a topic that I know very well. And if you look at who perpetrates these things and the situations in which they generally happen, we're barking up the wrong tree. Because there was a letter, I can't remember the name of the organization, but it's a coalition of like 250 different domestic violence survivor shelters, sexual violence advocacy, prevention and response groups. Like 250 of these groups came out and said, look, this is what we do, and this is a solution to a problem that doesn't exist. You're barking up the wrong tree. You're not making anyone safer by doing this, because there's nothing about a law that magically stops someone from entering a bathroom to hurt someone. That's already illegal. And the other thing to think about is, what's to stop a cisgender man from claiming to be a transgender woman and claiming he's required to be in the women's bathroom? So I respect where you're coming from. Mm-hmm. And like I said, I want to make it clear that it's something that I'm passionate about. I take that issue very, very seriously. But if you look at where these laws have been implemented and how they've been implemented, it's just not been a problem. And in every instance that you hear that the right drums up as, you know, this happening, there's always more to the story, such as someone who's a convicted sex offender being given access to a space they never should have been given access to in the first place, or some kids sneaking into a space they weren't supposed to be in the first place and seeing something they didn't like. You know, those kinds of things. So I definitely respect where you're coming from, but these bills, they don't make anyone safer, and they make the world objectively more dangerous for trans people. So it's not the solution.
That I can totally respect. Yeah.
Callie, thank you so much.